Hello and welcome to Crimewatch on the streets. Over the next hour,
we join the battle against the drug smugglers, supplying cocaine to the UK's street dealers.
Yeah, come on, I need this taxi pulling.
We're on the streets of Manchester, recovering guns.
Police, you hold the door, we're gonna put it in.
If we can stop any shootings tonight, then I'm a happy man.
And we're online, with the cops hunting paedophiles.
People can effectively make a phone call over the web and say, right, I exactly now want you to abuse this child.
For the past 6 months, our cameras have been given unprecedented access to live police investigations across the UK. We've witnessed undercover detectives in their hunt for paedophiles. We've even been there for the arrest. And we've been out on the streets of Manchester as cops recover guns. But we begin with the battle against cocaine, a Class A drug that starts its journey to the UK over 5,000 miles away. Most of the world's cocaine is produced in just three countries, Colombia, Bolivia, and Peru. And every year, scores of boats leave their shores carrying bulk loads of Class A cocaine destined for Europe. Around 40 tons, with a street value of more than £1.5 billion, will end up on the streets of the UK. Once in this country, the drugs have to be delivered to the dealers. In this case, a late-night train does the trick. Grampian police have been given a tip-off that this woman might be a drugs courier.
Do you have any controlled drugs in your possession?
From one station to another, and it's here at the Nick that she is thoroughly searched. As well as heroin, police find crack cocaine in her handbag, worth over £35,000. Crack is a smokable form of cocaine. It gives an intense high and is extremely addictive. Here in Aberdeen, it's become a significant problem. 10 times more crack cocaine is found here than anywhere else in Scotland. Those who become addicted can end up spending hundreds of pounds a day to feed their habit. This inevitably leads to crime. Okay. It's not just at train stations that police get their hands on the drugs, and today it's time to go drug busting. Our cameras have been allowed to follow the squad as they plan a surprise visit to a couple of local suspected dealers.
If you don't know them, both are from England originally. They've been living in Aberdeen for the last 4 or 5 years. Both are violent and have been volatile with the police during the execution of drug search warrants in the past. So if everybody can wear their body armour and just be aware that they might cause problems when we get there. The most recent intelligence is that both are involved in supplying crack and heroin.
The 12-strong team is heading to a notorious estate just outside the city centre. It's imperative their visit remains a surprise until the very last second.
We're going to park up just short of the address. There's going to be people covering the windows at the rear, because it's commonplace for persons within to try and dispose of controlled drugs on the police attending. and thereafter we're going to go in and try and gain control of the occupants. We've got one behind.
Police had planned to break the door in, but there's about to be a change of plan. On the way up the stairs, police come face to face with one of the suspects. It's a big stroke of luck. The man's arrested and police borrow his front door key. They can now enter the property without destroying the door. This element of surprise is essential. It buys them valuable extra seconds, and anyone inside will have no time to dispose of any incriminating evidence.
Please, show your hands!
Go on in here, secure.
Inside, police find two men and a woman.
Lock off the camera. What's the camera for?
The camera following us, okay, not you. They're following us.
What's that on my face for then when I was coming down there?
As well as a half-eaten Chinese takeaway, police find what looks like a stash of drugs.
The drugs on the table, so keep them away from him. None of you are obliged to say anything, but anything you do say will be noted down and maybe used in evidence. Does everybody understand that, first of all?
Anywhere that you can think of, pretty much we've found drugs. Sometimes folk are quite ingenious where they hide stuff, and other times most of the stuff's on open display and it's in people's pockets. And until we finish, you know, we can't say for definite that there's nothing else here.
It's increasing all the time, as you can see. It's just a matter of logging the items that are getting handed to me by the guys in chronological order from where they're found, so it takes a wee minute.
Basically what we'll have here is a bag with various street deals of what appears to be heroin and crack cocaine, colour-coded because there'll be different values of deals. These black bags here look to be what's known as half-teenth deals of heroin, I would suspect. And these will either be £25 rocks of crack cocaine or £20 bags of heroin. Chances are this package here contains further deals similar to these. From what we'll have in front of us, we maybe have £1,000 to £2,000 worth of drugs.
Officers search the suspects and every inch of the flat. No stone is left unturned. But it's not just drugs they find.
We find this towel, and within the towel there is a quantity of money. These are in hundreds. 1, 2, 3. There's 11 bundles, so I would suggest it's probably £1,100, but again, we'll count it once we get back to the office.
Police later find over £7,000 under the floorboards. Today's raid has been a success for the squad. Four people have been arrested and drugs and cash have been seized. Although police in this case have prevented cocaine and heroin hitting the streets, there is still a massive problem of drugs entering the country in the first place. 1,000 miles away in Lisbon, a new international drug-busting agency is targeting the supply chain nearer to source. A covert organisation called MAOC has been set up by the UK's Serious Organised Crime Agency and its European counterparts. It coordinates the naval forces of seven countries, including our own Royal Navy, in the fight against drugs. The aim is to intercept bulk loads of cocaine as they travel by sea between continents. Deploying the full weight of the Navy may seem like a sledgehammer to crack a nut, but it goes some way to showing the scale of the problem.
It's much easier to take out a load of 3 tons than it is to take out a lot of small loads, either when they arrive by couriers or when they're on the streets. Just think how many dealers we would need to arrest in order to stop 3 tons of cocaine reaching the marketplace and causing harm to the communities of each of the seven countries involved. South America, Colombia and Venezuela are the major exit points for cocaine destined for Europe. It'll come across the Atlantic, and we find primarily drugs are then taken sometimes into West Africa to be stored. If not, then they can come up the coastline towards Europe and offloaded further north. Those are the primary routes we're dealing with at the moment.
Right. We've had intel that a large amount of cocaine, possibly up to a ton, left Colombia last night on a small go-fast. And it's thought that the drugs will be transferred to the Pura Vida, a larger fishing vessel heading for West Africa. Do we agree on a search, approach and intercept?
Sir, yes, sir.
Right, who have we got out there?
HMS Montrose, sir. 50 miles off the Azores. So if they turn around, they can get to the area in 2 hours.
Get me the captain.
Decimal something west. Follow that position.
The Navy captain is quickly on board and heads in search of the drug smugglers. But the ocean is a big place to find a small boat like the Pura Vida. It doesn't pose a problem for the Navy, though. With state-of-the-art radar technology, they are quickly able to pinpoint the target.
Confirm G-pod's on and recording.
Send that. Yeah, make 5514, suspect 5514.
How are they getting on?
They've just picked up a vessel on radar, sir. It could well be the Pura Vida. Captain's launching the heli now.
Command intention to launch 308, conductor, initial investigation.
The aim of the smugglers is to get across the ocean as quickly as possible. The boats they use are often modified to outrun even the fastest naval vessel. But no boat can outrun a Lynx helicopter. The Lynx can operate 200 miles from its mother ship, giving the Navy a vital eye in the sky. A suspect vessel can be quickly located and its position relayed back to the frigate. This is actual footage of boats trying to outrun the Navy. In a panic, these four smugglers are throwing thousands of pounds worth of drugs overboard in a bid to get rid of the evidence. Unlucky for them, it was caught on camera. The drugs were later recovered. The helicopter has given the smugglers on board the Pura Vida something to worry about, allowing the frigate to catch up.
Currently have a visual at red 503 miles. Looks like a small power-driven vessel with a white superstructure and an orange top.
We have many reactions from criminals on vessels when a frigate steams over the horizon. But fear is a natural one. I think we would all perhaps look up a big grey vessel with very large guns on board with some fear and trepidation.
This is a coalition warship, Foxtrot 236. As a member of the United Nations forces enforcing the United Nations law of the sea, I am directed by the United Nations to use appropriate measures to insist on your cooperation. This may include the use of my weapons. Over.
Sir, the suspects are refusing to cooperate. The boarding teams are being launched.
The insertion will be by seaboat, away port and starboard seaboat.
The drug smugglers aren't giving up that easily. The Navy has no choice but to take their boat by force. It's time to launch the speedboats. Pura Vida has become what's known as a non-compliant vessel. So, heavily armed marines prepare to storm it, with or without cooperation from its crew.
Roger,
job done. This is actual footage from the most recent Mayoc drugs bust, using French naval forces to board a large tanker en route to West Africa. Below deck, waterproof barrels are found packed with 2.3 tons of cocaine, with a street value of over £100 million. In less than a full year of operation, Mayoc has coordinated 18 sea operations, preventing 27 tons of cocaine worth over £1 billion hitting the streets.
Mayoc is one answer to a widespread problem. Cocaine comes in by air courier, it comes in by container, it comes in by fishing vessel, and therefore we need to attack it across a wide sphere. But it's fair to say that the traffickers are seriously affected, because every time we take 3 tons of cocaine out, it's a huge financial hole in the pocket of a trafficking organisation, both in South America and in Europe. The more we hurt the traffickers, the less viable it becomes for them to traffic a drug, and then it will seriously affect the dealers.
Extraordinary stuff. Now, if you'd like to access extra footage or find out more about any of the stories featured tonight, then you can log on to our website at www.bbc.co.uk/crimewatch. Now, still to come...
The story of how police pulled the plug on one of the largest online paedophile rings in the UK. And this suspected paedophile gets an unexpected knock at the door.
Gun crime is a big problem. Last year in the UK, more than 500 people were killed or injured in over 7,000 incidents involving firearms. But there is hope. We've been out there on the front line with cops from Manchester and London as they battle to stop the shootings. Rav Wilding takes up the story.
It's Friday night, and the Excalibur task force are patrolling the streets of Manchester. Their aim is to target and disrupt known gang members, those most likely to be carrying a gun.
That's it. Yeah, come on, I need this taxi pulling.
Right, stop there!
The main aim of tonight is going to be out on the streets, finding out who's out and about, what gang members are out and about, trying to speak to them, trying to gather intelligence, trying to identify individuals who we need to pay particular attention to. As long as we're out there and they know we're out there, if we can deter any gang violence, if we can stop any shootings tonight, then I'm a happy man.
The team's following a suspicious car. In it, three youths.
Yeah, Claremont Road, suspicious vehicle.
Hiya, how are you doing, mate? I'm just in the middle of checking your car out, pal, when you pulled up. If you just bear with us, lads, I'm just going to check it out. Yeah, received. Thank you very much. Right, we'll just do the car rod.
Turns out, those in the car are known to police.
Just give us 2 minutes. Right, I'm just going to have a quick check of your car, mate. Because between you and your passengers, you've got warnings for drugs, violence and firearms.
The car is thoroughly searched, but this time, they find nothing.
Thanks very much, lads.
That doesn't mean it's a waste of time.
One of the individuals is violence, one of them is associated to drugs, and the third guy at some stage, he's had some involvement with firearms. If we can just be everywhere at all times, or at least let them believe that we're everywhere at all times, it'll stop them carrying a gun.
Since the task force was set up 18 months ago, disruption tactics like these have taken over 20 firearms and over 100 rounds of ammunition off the streets of Manchester. A few miles across the city, the team see a gang, about 20 strong, on the street.
I'm quite confident that they're probably all gang members. So, again, just as our usual tactics, fly in there, take them by surprise and just see who's there and what falls out. You watch this now, this will be Keystone Cops. These kids are like flipping Olympic athletes.
Get ready, go away.
Sure enough, one of them makes a run for it.
I'll stop.
Back up. Stand up against that wall, mate.
It turns out there's nothing on him, He just wanted to stretch his legs.
Is it this guy? Who caught him?
A bit of banter between police and the kids is no bad thing.
How did you catch him?
In fact, the cops go out of their way to get to know them, gives them a chance to identify the ones who can be helped away from the gang lifestyle before it's too late.
Yeah, pretty good, yeah. See you in a bit. See you, buddy.
My concern when I see a gathering of that size, blatantly stood there, we drive past, we see them. Anyone else driving past sees them as well. And what that said to me there was that it was just lining, they were lining themselves up for the drive-by shooting. That's what will happen on a case like this. You know, if opposing gang members are out and about in a stolen car or something, and they see that, there's every chance there's going to be a shooting. The day we stop talking to them, the day we can't speak to gang members, then I think the police, we might be losing the battle. As long as we can keep talking to them, you know, then we're on to a winner.
It's 6:30 in the morning. This is a big day for cops in Manchester. 250 of them have gathered for a special briefing. It's time for Operation Werewolf. Armed with safety equipment and a packed lunch, these officers are about to raid dozens of properties across the city. If successful, it could help them remove many dangerous weapons from the streets.
This operation, it's the end result of months and months of intelligence gathering by officers. We try and build up a picture of what's going on out there, who has access to firearms, and obviously we try and catch them.
First up, a flat in Trafford.
If one of you takes this corner, you're going to cover both sides. One of you takes the other, you're going to cover both sides. And what I want is when we're knocking on the door, anything comes out the windows, let it land. Right. It's going to be a bit busy up there, but just make sure no one touches it. See you up there.
Police,
you've
got to hold the door
when
I put it in.
10 seconds, it's going in.
Rather than risk a new door, police are let in.
How many have we got in?
Morning.
Okay, no one else?
He says nobody else is.
All right.
The occupant's caught totally off guard and police are quickly all over his flat.
Rod, do you want to go and get yourself set up in there, pal? Let's get organised.
They leave no stone unturned, but they don't find any guns. It's a frustrating start to the day for Chris and his team. But just as they're about to leave, they discover something suspicious in the bedroom.
Just one of these was just going to get a ball of cling film and nothing else.
Let's get rolling.
No, drugs.
Right, this bedroom is doing it again.
May I just slap your
wrist? Rip it apart. A number of pills in there, which I suspect is Class A, probably ecstasy. So to that end, he's going to be arrested on suspicion of possessing Class A drugs.
News is coming in from some of the other teams. Cross town, DCI Paul Miller is on his way to another raid. Word is, cops have made an important discovery.
This is the recovery they've had this morning. Still waiting for it to be forensically recovered.
It's a small arsenal of weapons, including a handgun, a flare gun, ammunition, even a crossbow. The owner has been arrested and taken down the nick for some tough questions.
Hiya.
The officers you just saw turning up there, they're from the firearms unit. They'll make the weapons safe now, so they can then be forensically recovered.
It's just after lunch and a few miles away, police, forensic and firearms officers have just arrived at a property. Within the last hour, they've been tipped off about something dodgy hidden in a gas meter box, just meters from where local children play.
In there?
Yeah.
Inside, there's a small pouch. But before they can see what's in it, a scenes of crime officer needs to make sure he doesn't miss any forensic opportunities.
Basically, we found a 9mm self-loading pistol was concealed in a bag. The pistol wasn't loaded, but was with a magazine in the bag with the pistol with six live rounds, 9mm rounds, that can be fired using that weapon.
It's a fantastic find for us. So I'm made up, you know, this is another gun that I've no doubt 10 individuals know of its existence. And it just takes one more gun away. I'm following on from this morning's successes where I believe we've had a number of guns back. You know, it's a good day for the cops so far today.
Whilst Manchester has its problems, it's London which is the gun capital of the UK. Over the last year, 30 people have been shot dead on its streets. Three quarters of London's shootings involve a victim and suspect, both coming from the black community. Operation Trident is the specialist unit set up by the Met Police to help bring down gun crime.
Well, it was set up in 2000 as a response to a number of crimes that had taken place in the mid-90s to the late 90s, and it was felt by the black community, and the advice we were getting is that you needed a unit to understand some of the complexities, some of the difficulties in dealing with these particular crimes.
And those difficulties often revolve around key witnesses being reluctant to come forward. But in one of Trident's most horrific cases to date, it was a very different story. The dad and his two daughters had their hands tied behind their backs. Three, shot dead from point-blank range. The treble murder of Noel Patterson and his daughters Connie and Lorna was one of the most horrific crimes that Trident had ever seen. And what made it more harrowing was that when police looked into the backgrounds of the victims, they discovered they were all completely innocent.
It wasn't to do with them, it was to do with someone who was close to the family who was involved with organised criminals. These are three individuals who were totally innocent and who were killed because of the criminality of others. It was obvious that the suspects had spent time in the address. It wasn't the sake of getting in and leaving the address, they'd obviously spent time in there. So we were hopeful we would be able to get forensic opportunities from within that scene.
But a thorough analysis revealed nothing. It was a devastating setback for police, leaving them with very little to go on.
The only witness left alive was a 9-month-old baby. There was no CCTV and a thorough forensic search turned up nothing. To solve this case, police needed the help of the local community, and that's where they got the breakthrough.
Was information come in within the first 7 days, which were all pointing in the same direction to who was responsible for this crime.
The name coming in from the community again and again was Rohan Chung, street name Chunky. There was also talk that Chung and someone close to the murdered family had been involved in a Jamaican drug deal and that something had gone wrong. Chung felt that he'd been done over. When police checked him out, they discovered a violent past and a love of guns. Chung was suspect number one.
We actually had surveillance on him for a number of weeks at different addresses in South London. We worked out where he was staying, who he was living with, who he was associating with on a day-to-day basis. And that was just building up a picture, so when we eventually decided he was going to be arrested for the offence, we knew where we could actually find him.
With surveillance done, it was time to bring him in.
Show yourself! Put your hands on your head! Face the wall! Turn away from me! Turn away from me! Get down on your knees! Do as I say, you will not be hurt!
We found a bullet. That bullet was forensically linked to the murder weapon. So again, that was, in some ways, was as good as finding the murder weapon at the address.
But another breakthrough would prove crucial in securing a conviction against Chung. Two brave men from Jamaica had the courage to say what they knew and were prepared to take the witness stand.
The evidence they provided built a picture up of what had taken place before, phone calls that had taken place afterwards, and their evidence, be given that live in court, was obviously very strong, and as a result, Rohan Chung was convicted.
Rohan Chung was sentenced to a minimum of 40 years in prison. His accomplice, Michael Letts, was also found guilty and sentenced to 20 years. Both will be deported when released. But for Trident, it's not over.
It was a successful case. Two individuals were sentenced for the murder of the three individuals at the address that night, but there's still, we believe, one suspect outstanding. Witnesses stated that there was three people seen on the estate that night. Two people have been convicted, so we're still making an appeal for that third individual. Anyone's got any information about him, please come forward in order we can get justice for the family.
This triple murder would not have been solved without some brave people coming forward. In fact, most Trident cases wouldn't be solved without help from the community. But that's easier said than done, and getting people to court is no mean feat.
The trust of the community, that's what we want. We want the community to trust with us. We want the community to work with us, to actually understand that we must have evidence and not just intelligence. We need a statement. We need a witness. We need somebody to come forward and say, this is what I heard, this is what I saw, this is what I know, and I'm prepared to give evidence in relation to that murder.
For potential witnesses who are scared to come forward, the police and Crown Prosecution Service can offer a variety of special measures. These are designed to keep your true identity a total secret.
Things tend to be gang-related. People know each other. Communities are small. People are scared to stand up and give evidence. And these are some things that we can apply for that make people feel a lot safer and a lot more secure about giving evidence. The first thing we would look at would be changing their name, giving them a pseudonym. Right from the beginning, they're safe in the fact that anything that we've got that we might speak to them about doesn't come up in their name whatsoever.
There are systems in place to protect it. It's not a case of somebody just walking into an office and opening a drawer and finding out, well, what the person's real name is. That's not like that. There is a very stringent, rigid system in place to protect somebody's name.
Hiding someone's identity goes much further than changing a name. Some witnesses are able to give their evidence via a video link, meaning they don't have to attend court. But for those that do, they can be covertly ushered in and out through private doors before giving evidence behind a screen. But what about a witness's voice? Well, there's a clever bit of kit that can take care of that.
It distorts the voice, disguising age, sex, even your regional accent.
Would you have known that was me?
Members of the jury, you have now heard the cases from the defence and the prosecution.
With a pseudonym, with voice distortion, behind a screen doesn't mean a major upheaval to a person's life. They can continue their life in the normal way. In fact, nothing has to change because nobody will know that they've come forward.
Measures like these have helped to convict many murderers. They are now a crucial weapon in the fight against gun crime.
Well, if you want to read more about so-called special measures and how they work, RAV has compiled a special report on our website. You can log on at www.bbc.co.uk/crimewatch. Next, the fight against paedophiles. Technology now makes it possible for anyone with internet access on a computer to download illegal images of child abuse. The problem is potentially huge, but undercover cops are now making real headway in pulling the plug on paedophiles.
These detectives from the Met Police paedophile unit are on their way to meet a suspected paedophile.
Nick, receive it, Dave.
Okay.
Is it possible? Can you see the subject? You've got eyeball at the moment. Is he on the phone?
We're just going to go and put a stopper on the vehicle that we think is him. Which one? This one?
This one, yeah. This is the guy, him. Is that here?
Right.
He thought he was meeting a 13-year-old girl he'd met online. He planned to have sex with her.
Sorry?
What are you doing here at the moment?
Well, I was waiting for someone.
Who are you waiting for?
Some girl.
Sorry?
Yeah, some girl we arranged to meet.
Who do you think you're meeting?
Yous lot, man.
Sorry?
Yous lot, man.
Right, okay. I'm arresting you for attempting to meet a child following sexual grooming. You don't have to say anything that may harm your defence, but you do not mention when questioned, something which you later rely on in court. Anything you do say may be given in evidence. So, yeah.
Yes.
Officers will continue this conversation back at the Nick. Paedophiles using the internet are the new criminals on the block. With the World Wide Web comes the global hunt for these online predators who produce and distribute horrific and disturbing images of child abuse.
People can effectively make a phone call over the web and say, right, I exactly now want you to abuse this child to order, just like going into a pizza shop and ordering a pizza.
These criminals use the internet as a cloak under which they hide both their identity and the crimes they commit. This World Wide Web of deceit is actually the net that catches them. One of the most complex cases to date was the hunt for an online paedophile who called himself Son of God. He was the so-called host of an online chat room called Kids, the Light of Our Lives. It was Canadian police officers in Toronto, part of the virtual global task force, who first infiltrated the chat room. They did so posing as paedophiles. It soon became obvious this dark and depraved online meeting place was being run from somewhere in the UK. A team from CEOP, the UK agency that combats paedophile crime, set about trying to track down the so-called Son of God.
We received the intelligence here at CEOP, immediately had a briefing in relation to that, and I walked down to the intelligence faculty, handed this information over and said, look, it's a priority case, this. I want this resolved as soon as possible.
They're telling us that there's a large online chat room being operated from within the UK. There are two questions that I need answering. Number one, who is the Son of God? And number two, where is he?
Within just 2 days, police were able to answer one of these questions. Computer experts had managed to trace the internet connection to a farmhouse deep in the heart of rural Suffolk. Was this the secret home of Son of God?
The initial reconnaissance of the address indicated to me that there were numerous buildings, numerous rooms, and that there were lots of computers potentially in any one of these rooms.
Suffolk police had set up an intensive surveillance operation, but nothing they saw seemed to tally with what the Canadians were seeing online. Here was a family running a business from home and living a normal life.
We couldn't really put a finger on anybody that would be in those premises that could be Son of God.
Detectives needed to see who was online at the house at the exact same time as Son of God was chatting to the Canadians. And then the breakthrough. Through a bedroom window, police watched a young man online to Canada. They had found the paedophile, calling himself Son of God.
Thank you.
was Timothy Cox. To all outward appearances, a normal 27-year-old who worked for the family business and was in a stable relationship. Not even those closest to him had any idea of the dark secrets he was hiding.
As soon as I identified Cox, there was obviously an initial urge in me saying, OK, let's go down there and kick the door in and arrest him. But I knew that couldn't be done.
Instead, police wanted to do something that they had never done before anywhere in the world. Detectives wanted to assume Cox's identity as the chatroom host. They wanted to become Son of God. Only as host could they identify and rescue the children being abused and catch those abusing them.
Yes, it's never been done before. Yes, there were risks involved. But all of this, the one thing that made us undertake the action that we did was there were children out there that were being sexually abused who didn't have the ability to even fight back.
With the global net tightening, split-second timing was going to be crucial. If Cox smelt a rat, police would lose the opportunity to seize control of his chat room.
I was at a location about a mile away from the address.
You can confirm that he's online now.
The undercover officers in Toronto, still posing as paedophiles, were chatting with Cox over the internet. It was their job to keep the online conversation going until the British arrest team was at his front door.
I was in communication with the undercover officers that were about to effect the arrest and given the word, OK, let's go.
That's a go.
Always a period of time where there's silence over the radio, and that's the time you're waiting for the arrest team to get into place. Sometimes it seems like hours.
Cox couldn't be given the chance to destroy evidence, so police needed a cover story to lure him away from the house.
Hey, mate. Uh-huh. You're the guys in the microbrewery?
Yes, mate. Yeah.
I may be interested in buying some stuff. Do you want to show me?
Yes. Sure. Come with me, mate. Yeah. It's just from Forrest, right? It's just round it.
Timothy Cox, I'm from Suffolk Police. I'm arresting on suspicion of making, taking, and distribution of indecent photographs of children.
Police, stay where you are.
Okay, we're in.
Cox is in custody. Confirm Cox is in custody.
With Cox in cuffs and his computer in their hands, police had got what they came for. The Global Task Force now controlled the chat room, whilst the hundreds of worldwide users were none the wiser. For them, it was business as usual. Police discovered that horrific child abuse was being carried out live on the internet. This interactive abuse meant that one paedophile could direct the actions of another. Anyone in the chat room could watch or take part. Suffolk police wasted no time in interviewing Cox.
There we were confronted with a young man in his 20s, very intelligent, articulate, very polite. He didn't kind of fit people's perception of what probably an internet paedophile should look like. He was probably the kind of man you'd see at a club or a bar and you know, would chat quite happily to him.
You may have got pleasure from it once upon a time.
Well, I suppose when I first found them,
right.
it was that kind of shock that it was that easy and it was there, and I just kind of couldn't believe it.
I got myself into a routine where it was just always on, it was always running, therefore it might as well always be downloading. mean, there were times when I stopped, but yeah, as I said, I don't know why now. I really don't know why.
Throughout the interviews, he remained quite confident, and he chatted quite openly, to the extent he sometimes came across almost quite arrogant. It was as though it was somebody talking about a collection of pictures of cars perhaps he'd have on the internet or something. There was no empathy and no remorse.
Cox was confronted with some of the explicit material found on his computer.
The fact that this girl has been tied while she's been raped. Her legs are tied, spread eagles. Yeah, I don't know what they're tied to, but appear to be tied with either wide bits of sheet or something similar. We had a comment to make with this?
Not really, no.
It's obviously a child being abused.
Mm-hmm.
For all to share. And what's your understanding of the law surrounding the sharing and viewing of this kind of image?
Well, no, it's illegal.
76,000 images of child abuse were found on Cox's computer, together with more than 300 hours of video abuse footage.
Within the first 24 hours, we had three very urgent cases which resulted in the saving of four children from around the world, some within the United Kingdom. And we effectively saved over 30 children within 10 days.
Police had identified all the major online offenders in the chat room. It was time to end the operation and shut the site down.
Boss, you're not gonna believe this. The chat room is up and running again.
The person now hosting the chat room was calling himself Silent Blackheart. Others knew him by his real name. Gordon McIntosh, an IT manager from Hertfordshire, who'd used his computer expertise to hack in and reopen the chat room. He had no idea that Cox had been caught. So, police once again adopted their online disguise, a son of God.
We came back online, entered the chat room and said, "Hi, it's Son of God, I'm back. Are you willing to hand the room back to me at 8 a.m. tomorrow morning?"
He took the bait, and at 8 a.m. police knew their man would be online. There was no cover story this time. They needed to get inside and get online.
His life was surrounded with child abuse images. His waking life, apart from work, was literally to be on the computer, talking to other paedophiles, and to exchange and download child abuse images. That was his whole life. He had nothing else in his life but that.
To their horror, detectives discovered that the chat room had built a substantial new membership. Police had their work cut out, but in the end, over 700 paedophiles from 35 countries were identified. To date, 120 arrests have been made in the UK alone.
These are very young children that are being abused by strangers, by relatives, by their family, and to actually take them out of an abusive situation to give them a normal life is just unbelievable.
There's nearly 40 children around the world who were being sexually abused horrifically that are no longer being sexually abused. They were in a very dark, cold place that nobody was going to help them from. And as a result of the activity of both these operations, those children are now in a safe place. And I think that's where, in real terms, we get our satisfaction from.
Both Timothy Cox and Gordon McIntosh were found guilty of making and distributing child abuse images. Both are now in prison and won't be out until authorities are satisfied that they are no longer a threat to children. CEOP have never allowed cameras to follow an undercover investigation, until now. Back in December, the team were on the trail of another suspected online paedophile. One of the undercover detectives has successfully made contact with him, posing as a paedophile.
I've told him that I do have children. He's taken a great interest in the son I'm alleged to have. And he certainly has asked me if I'd be prepared to provide my son for him so he could have sex with my son.
Right, and how old have you purported your son to be?
In this instance, 14.
OK.
And then he's also told me I can telephone him today, during the daytime, and we can continue the same way and have a chat.
Right, OK, well, we're going to take him up on his offer.
Yep.
You're all right for that?
Yeah, I'm fine, yeah. I'll get on with that and see. I'll get back to you and see what he says to me. OK,
I'll see you in a minute.
The team still don't know where the suspect lives, so the plan is that the undercover officer tries to set up a meeting with him.
How you doing? Yeah, are you OK to talk now, mate?
Yeah, this is the first time that CEOP have let an actual phone call be filmed.
Did you do that, yeah? That's something, I'll tell you what, that's something to look forward to. You just got to try and switch your mind on to what you're trying to achieve at the end of the day. The fact that if we didn't do this sort of thing, children would be abused. So unless we take this action, the whole situation continues. I've got the chance, come and say hello and we can see how we get on. All right, mate, good to talk to you, yeah? Take it easy. Ta-da, mate. Ta-da. I would probably cynically say it probably went better for him than me, in that he's still obviously getting aroused, even on the phone then. He perhaps got an indication that even when I'm trying to talk about something, he's constantly trying to talk about abusing children and what he would like to do, what he would like me to do. Having said that, on a positive note, he's given me directions for a meeting tomorrow, so from that point, yeah, quite a successful phone call.
But within minutes of the phone call, Ian receives a crucial bit of information, which means a last-minute change of plan.
We found out a third telephone number for this individual. That's been resolved to somebody who lives in Preston, who was arrested in around 1999 and got 2 years imprisonment, we believe, for distributing images on the internet.
CEOP now knows who he is and where he lives. They no longer have to rely on the suspect turning up for a meeting, and detectives can spend more time gathering evidence before they make a move on his address. It's a well-resourced operation. Lancashire detectives are backed up by a specialist support unit. They'll be needed if the suspect doesn't open up.
We've now built up a picture that this individual was potentially a bit of a loner. He is using the internet to obtain and share images.
We've identified the flat now. We're quite happy he's inside because the key's on the inside of the door. So that gives us a power of entry if he won't come to the door. But with that in mind, what we're going to do is we're going to get the support unit behind us with a door opener. So we need to make a rapid entry.
The investigation is rapidly drawing to its conclusion as officers arrive at the suspected paedophile's door. He can't be given any time to destroy evidence.
Please, can you just open the door, buddy? No, can you open the door? Can you open the door now?
He was seconds away from having his door knocked down.
Right, we're from Public Protection Unit. We're arresting you on suspicion of distributing and downloading indecent images of children. You don't have to say anything, right, but it may harm your defence if you fail to mention when questioned. Something which you later rely on in court. What you do say may be given in evidence. Okay. There's no pants on. We're going to get him dressed, searched, then we're going to take him away from here to the police station. Once we've done that, then they're going to conduct a search of the premises. Before we do that, we will give him an opportunity to tell us if there's anything in the house that we may find it that relates to the investigation.
Cool. My own experience of people like this is that they tend to be very, very cautious, very inventive, quite devious at times. Obviously, if you're committing this sort of acts, you're not going to be sort of shouting about it. So I've told the search team that I'm quite happy for them to be ripping up carpets, taking fronts off radiators, taking down light fittings. But by the time we leave here, I want to be quite happy that we haven't missed anything.
So far, we've found quite a large quantity of pornographic material, homosexual material. There are emails from another address, the content of which is already mentioning children, 13-year-olds, etc.
Oh, and more DVD.
It's quite disturbing, some of the stuff that we found already, especially the written items he's printed off his computer or off the internet, wherever he's got them from. They're quite disturbing, to be honest. I don't really want to say more about it. It's very offensive.
Today's gone quite well. We've managed to locate the suspect. He's under arrest and he's in custody at this police station at the moment. There's a lot of material that's been seized at the address, all of which has got to be viewed, so there's lots of inquiries yet to make. And there's some significant written emails that have been located at the address already that's been read, which contains very disturbing written material, which we'll be looking to act on quite quickly.
The man has been charged with the possession, making and distribution of indecent images of children. He'll be in court soon.
If you have any information regarding this or any crime feature tonight, then please ring Crime Stoppers anonymously on 0800 555 111. Crimewatch will be back live asking for your help to solve the latest cases in just 2 weeks. Monday, the 31st of March at 9 o'clock, right here on BBC One. Until then, good night.